it is you who light my lamp. The Lord my God lightens my darkness. For by you I can run against a troop, and by my God I can leap over a wall. This God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all those who take refuge in him. For who is God but the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? The God who equipped me with strength and made my way blameless. He made my feet like the feet of a deer and set me secure on the heights.
Forgive. cleansing first, the nail-scarred lamb, salvation's champion. Holy, holy,
as I think with us about offering this week, I want to take you back to a text that I listened to earlier this week in my morning devotionals from Exodus chapter 25, verses 1 through 8, in which God says to Moses, "Speak to the people of Israel that they take for me a contribution. From everyone whose heart moves him, you shall receive the contribution for me. And this is the contribution that you shall receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue and purple and scarlet yarns and fine linen, goat's hair, tanned ram's skins, goat skins, acacia wood, oil for the lamps, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones and stones for setting, for the ephod and for the breastpiece. And let them make me a sanctuary in which I may dwell in their midst." God's essentially saying to the children of Israel, give these offerings in order to make my presence visible on the earth. He says, and let them make a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst. Now we know, of course, and Solomon proclaims in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 27, that God can't be contained in any temple or any space for that matter, because God transcends time and space. The Solomon writes this, but will God indeed dwell on the earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built. But when the people of Israel gave for the tabernacle, their gifts, their offerings made God's presence visible on the earth. And when we give to God, we're also making God's presence visible, whether supporting the ministry of Moses Lake Christian Church or missionaries, both local and international, or benevolence for those who have needs. And so as you give, we understand that it's first an exercise in trusting God and acknowledging that he is the one who's providing for our needs. But also it's a matter of helping to make God's presence visible in our community and around the world. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the kingdom. And as you entrust us with God's resources, we're working to be creatively faithful in making God's presence visible, both in our ministry and the ministries we support here and around the world. You can give to Moses Lake Christian Church online through the website or through our app, or by physically mailing your offering or dropping it by MLCC. May God bless you as you give. Thank you for your faithfulness. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for what you give to us. We thank you for your faithfulness in providing for our needs. Help us to be good stewards, wise stewards, as we care for that which you've given us in your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. As you come to the Lord's Supper just now, I want to invite you to remember the body of Christ broken and the blood of Christ shed for us. Eucharist, which communion is often called, is a Greek transliteration meaning giving of thanks. And when we come to the Lord's Supper, communion, the Eucharist, we're giving thanks to the Lord Jesus for the great gift of life, his body broken, his blood shed for us. It's a time of reflection and examination. It's a time to experience the grace of God afresh as we remember Jesus' sacrifice for us. Thomas A. Kempis wrote in The Imitation of Christ, "With my hands outstretched on the cross and with my body naked, I willingly offered myself to God the Father for your sins. Everything in me was taken up in that sacrifice of divine propitiation. In like manner, you must willingly offer yourself to me as a pure and holy oblation, with your whole heart and soul, and as lovingly as you can. I ask nothing less of you but that you endeavor to resign yourself completely to me. Whatever else you offer me besides yourself does not interest me. I do not seek your gift. What I seek is you." The communion is a time of receiving Christ's sacrifice and giving ourselves back to him. Something he did once for all, something we do over and over as we remember. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, verses 26 through 30, we read, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. I tell you, I will not eat again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom.'" This is Christ's body broken for you. And this is Christ's blood shed for you. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your body broken and your blood shed. As we come this moment, we remember the great sacrifice you made for us, and we endeavor to the best of our ability and as lovingly as we can to give ourselves back to you, thanking you for your faithfulness, for the life that you've given us. It's in your name that we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.
There I was, empty-handed, crying out from the pit of my despair. There you were, in the shadows, holding out your hand, you made me there. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifted me up from the ashes, carried my soul from death to life. You never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, you never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, you never give up on me. Oh, you never give up on me.
Was a day that Yusuf and Miriam would never forget. I mean, one of those days that you know in your life, we're going to remember this day forever. It was the day that God showed up in Yusuf and Miriam's life and spoke directly to them. Oh, it was a message that they wanted to hear. It's a message that they needed to hear. God clearly spoke to them that day. Now, to be fair, it came through Moses, but they knew it was God's voice. You see, this is Yusuf and Miriam and baby Benjamin. A picture of them in the early days. To give you just a little bit of background on them, they were Israelites. They were part of the children of Israel that had been wandering in the desert for now almost 40 years. Yusuf and Miriam had been born while the children of Israel were wandering. They had seen their parents and their grandparents die. They had grown up as wandering with their family. They had met each other as teenagers and gotten married. And now there they were on the plains of Moab. 40 years the children of Israel had been wandering in the desert. And now that month had come. They were looking ahead at crossing the river and entering Canaan, the promised land. The promised land that they had heard about for so long. Now that time had come. And Yusuf and Miriam were kind of excited about crossing over, but they were also terrified. Because it wasn't just them anymore. You see, they had a baby Benjamin. Baby Benjamin had entered their family and they were so excited, but to be really honest, it caused a little bit of tension too. Well, we don't know what it's like to be parents. We don't know how to raise children. And now we're crossing over into Canaan with Benjamin, and they knew because they looked around and nobody had just one child. All their friends had three or four or five children, so they knew their family would grow. And they also knew that they had the responsibility of Benjamin and their future children. And they were crossing over into Canaan, and again, they were a little bit excited and a little bit terrified because they didn't know what to do. How are we going to raise this baby and our future children? What if we get it wrong? What if we're not great parents? We don't even know what to do. But even that morning, after they had had that discussion, and it was a frequent discussion for them, they heard the voice of God. They heard the voice of God speaking clearly to them as parents, as a family, as a couple. And again, it came through the voice of Moses. You and I can actually see that today, thousands of years later. It's in Deuteronomy. If you've got a Bible, why don't you open it to Deuteronomy chapter 6. And we see right here in Deuteronomy 6 from Moses what Yusuf and Miriam heard that exact day. You see, the children of Israel had grown to probably 2.5 million people. There were 12 different tribes, but each one of those tribes were made up of families. And Yusuf and Miriam and Benjamin were one of those families. And they stood that day and they listened to Moses of what he had to say to them. It's in Deuteronomy chapter 6. This is what Moses said to them that day. He said, hey, listen up, Israelites. Listen up, all of the tribes. Listen up, Yusuf and Miriam. I'm speaking to you from God. And Moses said to them in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1, he said, these are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing, the Jordan to possess, so that you, Yusuf and Miriam, and your children, Benjamin, and their children, future down the road, after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it will go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in the land flowing with milk and honey. That's the land across the Jordan. That's where you're headed. Just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. Today we know this as the Shema. This is probably the most quoted passage of Scripture ever. Because from this day forward, Jewish families would repeat these words. A prayer, a promise, a commitment. But on this day, for Yusuf and Miriam, they were hearing it for the first time. From God to them. These commands that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Oh, Yusuf and Miriam stopped right there and they kind of glanced at each other and said, that's good. We got to remember that. We got to remember to keep this upon our hearts first. But then the words came out of Moses' mouth, exactly what they were looking for, what they were searching for, what they couldn't articulate, but they knew that this is what they were after. What about our family? What about the generations behind us? What about the generations in front of us? He said they had seen their parents, they had seen their grandparents do some great things and really honestly make some really poor choices. But when Yusuf and Miriam got married, when they started their own family, they wanted to live out the right way and impact their kids for God. But they wrestled with and struggled with how. How do we do that? And the words they heard that day made sense to them. They would have to walk it out. They would have to figure out the implications, but it made sense when Moses said to them, Deuteronomy 6 verse 7, impress them upon your children. These commands that I give you today are to be on your hearts first, but then verse 7, impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. Moses stopped and almost as if he wanted to make a point. We just have it in Deuteronomy 6. It's only in here once, but the truth is that Moses stopped at this point in time and he reflected on that of just the significance. He actually had a little bit of pause and in that moment, Yusuf and Miriam looked up and they listened a little more intently. They reflected on those words as Moses said them again. Hey, these commands I give you today are to be upon your hearts. But then impress them upon your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Yusuf and Miriam stole a quick glance between each other and said, "That's it. That's it. That's the answer to the question that we've been asking." Because here's the question they were asking each other. What is the single most important thing that I can do for my kids, for Benjamin, for future brothers and sisters of Benjamin, for my family? What's the most important thing that I can do for my kids to help them succeed and feel at home in the world? Man, as we cross this Jordan River, as we go into Canaan, what is it that we need to do to make sure that Benjamin walks with God? That he doesn't get caught up in the culture and the life that we're entering into, really a life that we're not even sure what this looks like. We got married. We had lots of great ideas and plans, but now we've got children and responsibility, and we want to take that seriously. And so the question they were asking, God answered that exact day when he said, "Hey, these commands to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind, all your strength, are to be upon your heart first. And then second of all, impress them upon your children." Impress them upon your children. When you're walking in the way, when you get up in the morning, when you go to bed at night, when you're hanging out, pass it on to your kids. You see, the question that they were wrestling with is a question that a lot of us wrestle with as we end up with families and children. Maybe it's our marriage. It's the relationships around us. And sometimes we ask that exact question, don't we? Thousands of years later, what's the most important thing that I can do for my kids to help them succeed and feel at home here in this world, belonging to God, walking with God, being obedient to God, and yet also interacting with culture and life around me? How do I walk out and manage that tension? What is that thing that I can do? And here's what Miriam and Yusuf heard that day. Here's what I think Moses was trying to say, and here's what I think some things that you and I, as we spent a few minutes together this morning, what does that look like? And I want to challenge you that really I think what God is after, what's the single most important thing that you and I can do for our children to help them succeed in godliness in our family and outside our family as they interact with the world around them? What is that? What is that that we need to be committed to? And here's what it is. You know what? The number one thing we need to commit to, it's the power of presence. We need to show up. We need to show up. You're not the perfect parent. I'm not the perfect parent. And so many times we brainstorm, what do I need to do for my kids? What schools do I need to send them to? And schools are important. What kind of education do they need? What about their hobbies? Do I get them involved in sports? Do I take them and travel and let them see the world? We think about all these things we want to expose our kids to, and those are important things. But I think the number one thing that we can do for our kids, as we continue a series on the family here at Moses Lake Christian Church, I want to challenge you today that the number one thing you can do is show up. Show up in the life of your kids. This focus is less on what skills and abilities you want to build into your children and more on the relationship that you want to have with your children. Make that relationship a priority. You see, think about that very verse that Yusuf and Miriam heard that day, that thousands of years later we read in Deuteronomy. Look at how important showing up is. These commands I give you today are to be on your hearts. You got to live it out first, right? Not in perfection, but we live it out in our lives, and then we show up in the lives of our kids. We impress them upon our kids. We talk about them. Look at the action words here. When you talk, when you sit, when you walk, when you lie down, and when you get up. It's not about that one timely lecture. It's not about giving them a bunch of responsibility and then getting lost in my own world. And sometimes as parents, intentionally or unintentionally, We get so wrapped up in our own lives, our own worlds, our own jobs and our hobbies and the things that we're doing that we almost put our kids on autopilot and expect them to grow up and just catch it. Or maybe we take them to church and say, hey, it's the church's job to educate my kids in the ways of God. And what a privilege it is for us as a church to be a part of that conversation. But I want you to hear today, mom and dad, families here at Moses Lake Christian Church, what a privilege it is for us to come alongside you. But God's first idea for generational godliness is that godliness would come through the family. Yeah, families are struggling and families are broken and there's pressures and stresses, but that's why we have to commit to showing up to the power of presence in the lives of the people around us, especially our kids. It was Jim Elliot who said this, wherever you are, be all there. That's the power of presence. That's the power of presence. You see, showing up means exactly what it sounds like. It means being there for your kids. It means being physically present as well as providing a quality of presence. Provide it when you're meeting their needs, when you're expressing your love to them, when you're disciplining them, when you're laughing together, even when you're arguing with them. Showing up means bringing your whole being, your attention and awareness when you're with your child. The power of presence is me turning to my son, to my daughter, to my children, and giving them all of me. Not a distracted version of me. Not a multitasking version of me. Not trying to parent along the way, but parenting intentionally with the power of presence and showing up. Research on child development clearly demonstrates that one of the very best predictors for how any child turns out in terms of happiness, social and emotional development, their leadership skills, meaningful relationships, even academic and career success is whether they develop security from having at least one person in their life who showed up for them. That's an interesting question to ask each other, isn't it? Who showed up for you in your life? Who showed up in my life? Who were those significant adults who showed up? Or sometimes, regretfully, we say, you know what? It was nobody. My mom, my dad, my aunt, my uncle, whoever it was, I was left abandoned. And so much struggle comes with that. And I know we're talking about children right now. I'm challenging us as families and moms and dads. But just on a side note, I want to say that this is true for every relationship in our life. Husbands and wives, one of the greatest gifts you can give each other is showing up with all of your presence. Grandparents, one of the greatest gifts you can give your grandkids is to show up in their life intentionally. Over and over and over again, giving them the power of your presence, the gift of your presence to our coworkers, to our neighbors, to our church family. The gift of time, the gift of presence, the power of showing up. That's what God was after through Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 6. But it doesn't just stop there. The power of presence is something that Jesus walked out, right? Think for just a second about Jesus. So many times he showed up in people's lives. Maybe you think about Zacchaeus in Luke chapter 19, right? Jesus walking along the road and he stops and he looks up at this little tax collector sitting in a tree. He could have had a conversation there with him. He could have lectured him. Zacchaeus had shown up to learn about Jesus out of his curiosity. But Jesus stops and he gives an invitation. He says, hey, Zacchaeus, how about if you come down from the tree because I want to go to your house today. I want to have a meal with you. And Zacchaeus' eyes got big and he looked around and sure enough, Jesus was talking to him. And before he knew it, he had gotten down from the tree and he had walked up to Jesus and Jesus said, so where do you live? I want to come to your house. And Jesus went to Zacchaeus' house and gave his time, his presence, his uninterrupted presence in love, compassion, and some challenge. They sat over a meal, and when they walked out of Zacchaeus' house, Zacchaeus was a different man, a transformed man. Think about the woman at the well. Think about Jesus in the middle of the day, hot, tired, sits down at the well and engages a woman who we find out later was really ostracized from her town, didn't have a great reputation. John chapter 4, you can read that story, but Jesus sits down and he gives this woman his attention, his time, his presence. He showed up in her life by just seeing her, by hearing her, by having conversation with her, a conversation that led to change in her. Think about the very disciples that Jesus called. There's lots of ways that Jesus called his disciples, but one of my favorites shows up in John chapter 1. You got John and Peter, and later you have Andrew there, and they meet this rabbi, and they have a conversation with him. And they ask the rabbi a simple question in John chapter 1, verse 38. Hey, rabbi, where are you staying? Pretty kind of a common question at the time. They had been fishing. They had a business. They interacted with Jesus. And then they ask him, hey, just curious, where are you staying? You know how Jesus answers their question? He answers it with an invitation. You look at it. John chapter 1, verse 38 says this. Hey, rabbi, where are you staying? And Jesus says, come and see. Come and see. Come hang out with me. And that invitation would turn into 3 years of relationship daily. Coming and seeing. The power of presence. Remember Deuteronomy 6? As you get up, as you walk, as you talk, as you go to bed, as you interact in daily life, impress it upon your children. We're called to do that as parents. We're called to do that as husbands and wives and grandparents and aunts and uncles and friends. And it was something that Jesus lived out. You see, Jesus very much believed in that relationship is the bridge that truth walks across. You see, as a culture and society, we are so committed to truth, right? We want to make sure the truth comes across, the truth comes out. We want to be right. And it causes so much tension, so much strain on relationships. Because a lot of times how we want to deliver the truth is through the spoken word. And what's missing and what's lacking is relationship. But God's heart is that he created us to be in relationship. He created Adam and Eve. He created the family. He created the church. He put us in community. And think about the times when truth has really been delivered in your life and delivered to you, where it made sense. It took root and grew and produced good things. My guess is it probably came through relationship. It came through trust. That relationship was probably with God, as God speaks to us by his word, by his spirit. As we trust him for life and godliness, he shows up in relationship first and then truth. You think about significant mentors in your life, maybe coaches, maybe people that spoke truth into your life that took root and traction. It's because you had relationship. It's because you had trust. You see, relationship is the bridge. The truth walks across. The power of presence. The power of showing up. Dan Siegel in his great book, The Power of Showing Up. How parents can show up in the lives of their kids. Says that really there's four S's to showing up. The first one is this. Is when we show up in the lives of our kids, we want to help our kids feel safe. Protected and sheltered from harm. I'm not talking about putting them in a bubble. I'm not talking about always keeping them from all the risks. No, we need to allow our kids some freedoms. inappropriate ways for their age and their time. But you know what? Your kids need to feel safe, protected, that you are there for them to keep them from harm. Now, your kids also need to feel seen, that they know you care about them and you pay attention to them. Your kids need to feel safe. They need to feel seen. They need to feel soothed. They need to know that you will be there for them when they are hurting. I love that, right? You get the picture of a little boy falls down, skins his knee, has blood. What does he want to do? He wants to run over to his mom or his dad and say, "Look, I'm hurt." And those moments are so important. Oh, let me see. Hey, I think you're going to be okay. Let me give it a kiss. Let me help you. You know what that is? That's soothing. That's showing up. Not just physical hurts, but sometimes it's relational hurt. It's your teenager in your home who's maybe struggling with a relationship and they're hurting emotionally and they need you. They need us to show up, to soothe, and to say, "Hey, I'm here when you're hurting." Our kids need to be safe. They need to be seen. They need to be soothed, and they need to be secure. That they trust you to help them feel as safe in the world and at home in the world. That, hey, you know what? No matter what happens, I know that mom and dad will be here. I know that my significant adult in my life, my grandparent, my aunt, my uncle, my friend will be there. No matter what. I remember for us with our kids, when we were tucking them into bed at night, as they were growing up, I loved to ask a simple question of them. I'd look at one of my four and I would just ask this question: "Hey, what do you know for sure? What do you know for sure? Of all the things in the world, what do you know for sure?" And here's what I wanted to hear, and here's what I wanted them to remember. As they answered back to me, "Dad, I know two things for sure. One, I know that God loves me. And I know the second thing, that you and mom love me." And then I would give them a kiss, short prayer with them at night. I wanted them to know that no matter what happens in the world, God loves you and I love you and your mom loves you. And we're here for you. You see, the power of showing up in the lives of our family, our children, our husband, our wife. The power of showing up, that they would be safe, they would be seen, they would be soothed, and they would be secure. Remember Deuteronomy 6? How does that happen? You know, it happens on a day-to-day basis. It happens on a moment-to-moment basis. It happens really, and I've just given you a short list here of what are the things that we need to practice. How do we show up? You know what? I would challenge you to have a family meal together. Oh, it's so easy in our culture to just eat food on the run, right? Maybe with the TV going or being distracted or just grab something. Sit down as a family and impress upon your children. Show up in their life. According to a nonprofit organization operated by Harvard University, listen to the results of this study. Kids who eat with their families roughly 5 days a week exhibit lower levels of substance abuse, teen pregnancy, obesity, and depression. They have a higher grade point average, better vocabulary, and more self-esteem. You know what else happens? They see godliness showing up as we sit as a family over a meal. It seems like such a simple thing, but it's such a lost thing in our culture today. I would challenge us to have family meals together. To turn off your phone, to turn off the TV, to learn to ask each other good questions. What was the best part of your day? What was the hardest part of your day? What are you excited about? Eat a family meal together. Take a family vacation. Date your kids or your spouse. Show up for your kids. When our kids were young, I just had the habit, and my wife had the habit, of grabbing some lunch, and once a week we would go and have lunch with our kids at their school and just go on a date with them, or take them out to ice cream, or spend some uninterrupted time. We had four kids, and so we had to rotate every other week. My wife and I, we would get to our kids and have a date with them. My wife and I have committed to have a date with each other. Now it's Wednesday afternoons at 4 o'clock. We try to get out once a week just to sort of be uninterrupted and to focus on each other. Not that we don't see each other all week, we do. But the habit of showing up and putting it on the calendar, making it a priority. Date your kids, date your spouse, show up to their games or their events. Tell them daily you love them. Go hiking together, ride bikes together, learn to ask good questions of each other. Read to your kids. Have family devotions. Pray with and for your kids and your spouse. Do chores together. Teach your kids to drive. Watch TV together. Play video games together. Instead of just being frustrated that that's all my kids do, enter into that world and learn. Do it with them. Have fun together. Know your kids' friends, their schedule, their life. Enforce no screen time in your house, including you. It's so easy for us to be distracted by our phones. Turn your phone off. Set it down. Practice entrances and exits. What a powerful thing. That as we get ready to leave our house or enter our house, we would stop and we would see each other and greet each other. The rule in our house was that as the person enters in, the people that are in the house, it's their responsibility to get up and greet them. Hey, it's good to see you. I wanted to communicate a message to my kids and to my wife that I'm glad you're home. It's good to see you. I don't want to just be two ships passing in the night. I want to show up for my wife, for my children, for the relationships in my life. We got to learn, especially us as guys, we got to learn to say no to more work and yes to my kids and my spouse. A lot of us, we love our jobs, and as guys, we're doers, and we get it done. And it's easy to just spend a little more time at the office, maybe just another extra day, get that project done a little bit further. And I'm a high-capacity worker. I love to work. But you know what? Every time I say yes to work, I am saying no to something else. And oftentimes, that's my family. And so is my family a priority? Am I showing up in the lives of my children? There's always going to be more work, guaranteed. It'll be there. And I'm not talking about neglecting your work. I'm not talking about, you know, not doing your part. No, we need to work hard. God tells us that. But I need to learn to say no to my work and yes to my family. Deuteronomy 6. What Yusuf and Miriam heard that day was, these are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, Yusuf and Miriam, and your children and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all your decrees and commands that I give you, so that you may enjoy long life. And here's the good news. For Yusuf and Miriam that day, they took this to heart. Oh, and they went on to have actually three more children. They had a family of four kids, and Yusuf and Miriam, and they entered into Canaan. But they never forgot that day when God showed up and spoke to them. And they made it an intentional practice to show up for each other and show up for their children. And oh, they had their struggles. You know, those teen years were tough, but God was with them. God strengthened them. And as they showed up in the life of their children daily, talking with them, walking with them, when they got up, when they went to bed, as they practiced family time and made their kids a priority and showed up, so did God. And Yusuf and Miriam saw generations of godliness come from their family because they believed and were obedient. And made a decision to show up and practice the power of presence in the lives of each other and their kids. And God showed up in their midst. He did his part as they did theirs. How about you? How about me? Thousands of years later, the truth is still the same. How are we doing practicing the power of presence? Showing up. In the lives of our kids. Maybe you need to look back on that list and say, you know what? What are the things that I could add to my life? Maybe I need to start a date night with my wife or my kids. Maybe we need to start having family meals together, take a family vacation. It's not so much about what you choose to do, it's the fact that you would choose to do it. To stop and evaluate, how am I doing showing up? It's easy to get distracted. It's easy to have the best of intentions, but not walk through and commit to what God calls us to do. I would challenge us this week, the same way God has shown up in our lives, the same way Jesus practiced showing up, let's show up in the lives of each other. Let's start with the people that are right around us, our wife, our husband, our children, our grandchildren. Watch God move in your heart and in their hearts as we practice the power of presence, showing up. God bless you as we walk that out this week.